very warm welcome to all of you for this opening event in the Vienna Humanities Festival 2024. My name is Misha Glennie, and I'm the Rector of the Institute for Human Sciences, the IWM, IWM. And we are organizing the festival this year, as always, together with Time to Talk. And it's a very special evening tonight. We have the opening session in our festival referred to as Uncharted. And this is uncharted territory, partly because, although life at the moment is very anxiety-inducing and difficult, we thought we would counter all that by having a rather unexpectedly joyful first event at the Vienna Humanities Festival. It's also uncharted territory because it's the first time that the VHF has hosted a global rock star for one of its sessions. My guest tonight is considered one of the greatest living guitarists. He experienced the fame and glamour of being an early member and stalwart for many years of Roxy Music. Equally, though, he is a sought-after music producer, helping bands to reach their full potential, particularly bands in the Spanish and Latin American world, and we'll find out why that is the case. But he's also played as a guest musician for many of the greatest bands and musicians of the world, David Bowie, 10cc, Pink Floyd, Jack Bruce, and many more. And as we shall find out, he has had an unusual life trajectory, as is recorded in his recently published autobiography, From Revolution to Roxy, and he's agreed to sign copies of that in the interval. So all rush to that table, get your copy, get him to sign it. Please welcome onto the stage El Magnifico, Phil Manzanera.
Whoa.
Now, Phil has a very complex technical setup because during the event he will be playing us a few songs, which is great news, but that involves some complex Bluetooth tech, and Phil's going to tell me when he's ready to go. We're not going to start with a song, but we will get to one fairly soon. But instead, before we get to the music, we're going to talk about his early life, which is, I can tell you, it's a surprising story. I've got a clicker too. Let's see if my clicker works. It won't because it's off at the moment, because we've got a few pictures. There we are.
Oh, yes, that works.
That works. We can
continue.
Okay.
Well, can I just say hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. It's great to be here in front of all you lovely people. And I was just saying to somebody earlier today, this is off script, by the way.
I know it's off script. I don't know what you're going to say.
You're going to have to stop me, Tom. the first time I came and played here with Roxy Music was on the 1st of December 1973, before you guys were born, probably. But anyway. Anybody there at the, where was it, the concert?
In 1973, I'd already seen you by 1973.
Sure.
Yes, it was Wembley. I'll tell you about that later.
Okay. Sorry. It continues.
So that was the first time you came in. You've been here a couple of times since, I believe.
Yes, I did look on YouTube and saw that we did something on television here in Vienna in 1979, and there was an interview with me, Brian Ferry, and Andy Mackay, which looked very tense.
Yeah, because they were interviewing you, asking why you'd broken up.
Again, yes. Yeah. But anyway.
Well, look, before we get to Brian Ferry and the rest of them, let's go back a little, because you were born in London in January 1951 as Philip Jeffrey Target Adams, not as Phil Manzanera. But you spent many of your early years in Latin America. So what were you doing in Latin America?
Well, specifically, yes, you're right. I was born opposite the Houses of Parliament, so you can't be more British than that. I was taken to Havana in 1957. Not literally taken, you know, abducted or anything. But my father, whose surname I thought was Target Adams, a very British sort of construct name, double barrel names. But as I discover when I'm about 40,
that's the iPhone going off.
Yeah, that's somebody trying to get in touch. well, that wasn't really my name, actually. Well, the more I think about it, Target Adams was just, you know, it turned out that my grandfather really was a Neapolitan opera musician.
A Neapolitan opera musician?
Yes, yes. On my father's side, yes, because... But I only discovered this, you know, after my mum and dad had died at the age of 40, and I was absolutely gobsmacked and just so pleased, because it's so much more exciting than being born to a normal sort of...
But also that possibly explains your musical ability.
Well, I have thought about that, but anyway. So I was taken to Cuba and put into a Cuban school, and within 3 months I could speak Spanish. And my mother was born in Colombia, in Barranquilla, Colombia. So... She was called Magdalena, and she lived right beside the most famous river in Colombia called the Rio Magdalena. And the Magdalena River is like the Mississippi. It goes through the whole of a country, and all the history of Colombia is bound up in this river, Magdalena. So it's quite amazing that she was caught. And her father was the captain of a paddle steamboat that went on the Rio Magdalena. And actually, they copied the paddle steamboats from the Mississippi, actually. And you probably all know, but that's how the conquistadors got into South America, up the Rio Magdalena, up into the Andes and stuff. Anyway, I digress.
So back to you're a 6-year-old boy,
yeah,
and you're taken to London Airport, as Heathrow was known at the time.
Heathrow,
literally, two words.
Nissan huts.
Yeah, Nissan huts for an airport.
And then you sat in armchairs, and then you got on a plane. I don't know. Is there a picture?
Yes, I think there is. I think there's a picture of... Oh, there! No, those are your famous diamond glasses.
Yeah, bug eyes, yeah. Old bug eyes is back.
That's you just before you go to Cuba. And very sweet, I agree. And there it is, British Overseas Airways Company, or whatever the full name was.
And it's actually called a Stratocruiser. And it's an amazing plane, because it had a bar, downstairs bar. in it, and because my father worked for the airline company BOC, obviously we were in first class, and they had couchettes like on trains, because this is the transition between traveling on luxurious Pullman trains and air
and going on to it. So it's, yeah. So it's really,
so they'd pull down this thing, and you'd, you know, there'd be a bunk up and a bunk below, and then the bar downstairs. So it's a absolutely fabulous. So it's led to a lifelong interest in aviation.
Oh, in aviation.
And then obviously in Cuba, mojitos and, you know, don't
so go. So you arrive in Havana, but you're 6 years old. And
yes.
You've just come from 1950s austerity, grey, rainy Britain. And you're suddenly in the playground of the American rich in the Caribbean, in Havana, because Batista is still in power at this stage, right?
The dictator is in power. Mafia are having conventions in Havana at the Hotel Nacional, and they are controlling the nightclubs, the Tropicana, the Sans Souci. There's gambling, lots of casinos. So it was like taken over, basically, by the... Actually, to tell you the truth, I think after Havana, after the revolution, they started up Las Vegas.
Yeah, they went They went so from there. They needed somewhere to
play
their
history.
Trade.
We're talking about history here.
Yeah.
But anyway, yes.
But so for you as a kid, what was it like suddenly?
Well, for me, as a kid, it was very exciting coming from the monochrome London to this technicolor world, palm trees, exotic dancers. I used to be taken to these nightclubs and basically be asleep on the table while my parents watched all this incredible dancing and incredible musicians and incredible music. And in fact, some of the people from who ended up in the Buena Vista Social Club were at their prime.
Were playing.
And were playing. Ruben Gonzalez played at the Tropicana Club. I probably saw him. I had obviously had no idea who the musicians were, but by osmosis, this kind of music must have gone into my brain. And then, of course, all the dancing girls with the plumes. Did you see the 2001 Roxy tour? 18 dancers with big plumes.
And that was all inspired by your
but
time in
no,
Cuba.
It wasn't actually. It was inspired by Brian Ferry going to a club the night before the tour. I've seen these incredible dancers. We need 18 of them. There goes the budget, you know. So. By the end of the tour, there were four. That's all I can say.
Sorry, I'm having difficulty with the clicker.
We jump ahead.
But I may just go and switch the clicker anyhow.
Yeah.
Anyway,
oh,
not the end of
it's changed. Actually, that is me just arrived at the Hotel Nacional in Havana, age 6.
So what is the Hotel Nacional? Oh, that's the revolution.
Okay. Oh, no, that's my mum's guitar. Okay.
So the Hotel Nacional, tell us about the Hotel Nacional.
The Hotel Nacional still exists. I don't know. Has anyone been to Havana? No. Oh, it's terrible. Come on. It's very, it's a lot of fun. And it's a pink hotel that, you know, Churchill stayed at, Roosevelt, all the most famous actresses and actors of the 30s, 40s stayed in. It's an iconic hotel on the place called the Malecón, which is the main drag that leads to the port in Havana. And it's an incredible hotel that, well, I've been back a few times and stayed at there. And I mean, not many things work at the hotel, but that's just symptomatic, I'm afraid, of the troubles that Cuba are going through.
So you must have loved being in this place.
I loved being in that place. I loved going to school and meeting these young Cubans. And then my mum decided to have guitar lessons with this lady. Actually, that's not my mum. That is a lady called Franca, and she was the wife of the British consul in Havana at the time. Now, my mum and dad had sort of lived in Colombia, in Argentina during the Second World War. We ended up in Venezuela at one point, but we always seemed to be in places where there were trouble. There was trouble. And we always were very friendly with the British ambassador and the British consul and all those people. If I say that when we were in Havana, 100 yards from my dad's office, Graham Greene was writing Our Man in Havana. Now, Graham Greene was MI6. It's no coincidence that we had lots of cameras, lots of movie cameras, we had shortwave radios, and we always were in troublesome spots. So there is an idea that maybe my dad did work for MI6. But if there's anybody in the audience from MI6, perhaps they could make themselves known. And
it sounds to me very much as though he did work for MI6.
Well, he could have done, but of course all the files are closed.
Because you were there when the revolution breaks out.
Yeah.
So tell us about the revolution. There we are. There's the one of the pictures of it.
That actually is a still from when. Is Fidel in there? I think, I'm not sure if he is, but they showed this on the television. I watched this live on the television, them coming into Havana. And the night before had been New Year's Eve. And I don't know if any of you have ever watched The Godfather Part 2. Yeah. Well, there's a fantastic scene, a recreation of New Year's Eve in the presidential palace of Batista, the dictator. And what happens on New Year's Eve is that someone comes rushing into this big party in the big ballroom and says, Che Guevara and Camilo Cienfuegos have taken this town called Santa Clara and they're on their way to Havana on tanks. So panic ensues and they all rush for their cars and they all rush off to the military airport to Scarpa. Now, if you had a drone and you could go up and move it to the right 4 miles, you would see our house and our garden and a gun battle going on with us in the bathroom, my sister, brother, my mother, my mother screaming, pushing our faces on the floor, bullets flying everywhere. And we live not only opposite the chief of staff of the dictator, but near the airfield where they were all rushing to. And so now, you know, I have a vivid memory of this, but we eventually, 3 months later, all the foreigners had to leave. It was too dangerous, and there'd been lots of looting going on, and they'd put guards on the houses to stop people just turning up with their cars and just going in and taking all the crystal and cutlery and all sorts of stuff. And I actually went in to the house because I took a cup of coffee to the guard, and this, you know, we're talking about what seems now like a joke, sort of Woody Allen type guy with, oh, I thought that was my phone, with 303 shells and a machine gun and all that. He was sitting there all day, bored out of his brain. And my mum said, take him a cup of coffee, poor chap. So I took him a cup of coffee, and he let me go in, and I took what a seven-year-old by then would take. I took the gold epaulettes from his dinner jacket. I took a photo album which showed a lot of British Royal Air Force people with planes and the Cuban Air Force, which I'd never really heard about before. Mysteriously, that disappeared in Venezuela, by the way, that photo album, when my father died. You know, it was, the other incredible thing is that they had merchandise. And the day after, these trucks came down the street and they handed out little caps.
Selling T-shirts and...
Not selling them, giving out free, you know, Fidel caps and armbands. So, you know, we were all like running around with things. So they were really up on merchandise, on publicity. But, you know, eventually we left and my father got posted to Hawaii. And he did an interview for the Honolulu Press. And, you know, in it he describes exactly what happened, that night, and it describes the gunfight from our house, and describes that he had a gun. I had no idea he had a gun. So
the evidence is mounting
it was all there. So, you know, half the time, in a lot of this memoir, I read this stuff and I think, did I make this up? This is ridiculous, you know. But I have, you know, photos and I have newspaper articles.
I had one just a minute ago. I have one of your father, I think, which tells us.
Oh, well, this is...
There he is.
This was actually when they lived in Buenos Aires. This was during Perón, the revolution, you know. So and then the next picture was my mum holding the paper, revolution, you know. It's like... There's a few clues there.
I think the evidence is fairly conclusive. But didn't he also work for the British Council?
He did work for the British Council. Ah, yeah, before BOAC. Because BOAC, which is now British Airways, BOAC was owned by the British government in the 50s. So it was another branch of the British government. You know, it would seem quite obvious and natural that any intel from Brits working abroad would be sent back if you were working somehow for the government. Just nothing, you know, serious. I don't know if you've read Our Man in Havana. When he makes out that he's a...
Isn't he selling Hoovers.
He sells Hoovers, but he's drawn these plans that make it look like an atomic bomb.
Yeah.
That in London, they think, you know.
I think this is a good moment for you to play your first song, which is called Magdalena. You've already told us about the river. Tell us about the inspiration to the song before you...
You know, when you write an instrumental song, you can call it anything you like, really. And I decided that I should do a song dedicated to...
I was pointing it in the wrong direction. There we are. This is his mother with the...
Oh, that's loud. So I thought I'd do a song that's dedicated to my mother. And so I called it Magdalena, and it has a sort of very nostalgic element to it for me. It sounds quite Latin, and I guess in my imagination it's probably based on a few different Latin things. But anyway, here we go. Thank you.
Great stuff, Phil, great stuff. And there'll be more from you in a minute too. So before we leave Latin America, I want you to tell us, I want you to tell us about your most infamous ancestor, David Cohen Enriquez.
Right, well, as I said, my mother was born in Barranquilla, Colombia. Her mother was born in Curaçao, in the Dutch Antilles. Now, because of Brexit, I'm jumping ahead all the centuries now.
Although it is one of our favorite subjects.
It is, yeah. Because of the self-harm that we inflicted on ourselves, it turns out that if you could find out you had Sephardic Jewish ancestry, you could get a Spanish or Portuguese passport. So obviously my 50 cousins in Colombia were very, very interested in that. So I was doing the book, I started doing research, and what it led me to was, well, let's go back to 1492. I went back to 1492, Sephardic Jews expelled from Spain, went to Portugal. Inquisition came to Portugal, chucked out of Portugal, went to Holland. From Holland, they went not only to England, actually, Cromwell invited them over to take care of business in the city. They also went to the Dutch Antilles. And so somewhere along that route, I was just Googling away and the names on Cohen Enriquez, which was the name of my grandmother and all her great-grandmothers and things like that. And I came across the most famous Jewish pirate of the Caribbean.
I think possibly the only Jewish pirate of the Caribbean.
Well, Moses Cohen Enriquez, he's got his own Wikipedia page. Yeah, it was too late to put the painting of him in the book, but he looks a bit like I did when I joined Roxy, with the hair and the boots. It's a dead ringer for this guy. And he was infamous because what he did, he attacked one of the Spanish fleets, was taking all the gold back, as they all did, from Mexico and from South America, back to Spain. And he attacked this flotilla on the northern coast, it turned out, of Cuba. So it's all like connected.
It's all coming together.
And it was equivalent of billions of euros, pounds, dollars in today's money. Absolutely caused sensation everywhere. He was the most sought after buccaneer pirate. So he escaped and bought himself an island off Brazil. Then the Portuguese turn up. They take Brazil, don't they? So he scarpers back to the Caribbean and ends up as the money bag man for Captain Morgan. Captain Morgan, most famous British, actually Welsh, pirate.
Morgan, of course.
Right, to be sure.
Yeah. It would be Welsh.
so he becomes totally infamous, and they never catch him. But so what happens is, I put a bit of this family tree up here, and we were in Cartagena at the Hay Festival talking about all this in January this year. And as soon as we left Cartagena, me and my wife Claire, we went to Curaçao, and my daughter came down from New York to try and investigate and find out more about this family, the Cohen Enriquez family. And we did eventually find all their gravestones. You don't know this because last time I saw you was in Cartagena, and we were about to go off on this mad trip where we discovered all these incredible things. And we eventually end up in the archives of Curaçao, in a special museum where it's a very modern and absolutely brilliant. And I go in and I say to the lady, do you by any chance have the death certificate and birth certificate for blah, blah, my grandmother and this? And say, oh, yeah, got all that. And this is what you need to be notarized to get your passports. You see, so I did a good turn for my cousins. But when we're flicking through all the books that they have, which are main history books, are out of print, who should turn up? Moses Cohen Enriquez, the pirate. And, you know, he'd had to scarper from some other island. He was on the run. But there he was. And I filmed all this, actually, to show to my cousins. So we actually discover him.
And as a result, Spain and Portugal have 50 new citizens from...
50. Possibly, potentially. There are a hell of a lot of them, actually, yeah. And their children. Anyway, sorry.
That's all right.
That's in the book. That's the other thing that I was... You know, the book does have stuff about being in a rock band and being in Roxy and playing with all Dylan and whatever, but it is also a whole series of stuff about me trying to make sense of where I come from as a family and our family, where we come from.
So you come partly from South America, but you go from South America back to London where you attend boarding school. In London, again, a very, very different atmosphere.
I begged my parents to send me from Venezuela to South London to a British boarding school because I used to listen on the World Service BBC and hear the music that was coming out of England. And by then, I was obsessed by a British boy had come over and showed me some Chuck Berry riffs and all this kind of thing. I said, send me to London, send me to England. So age 9.
At the very beginning of the swinging 60s, you're going to boarding school. This is a lot going on. You have the music scene explosion in Liverpool and then in London. You're still relatively young. How do you get recruited into Roxy Music?
Well, yeah, obviously, I was 9 then. By the time I left school, I was 18. And
you write in your autobiography that you were very keen to make it as a guitarist because it meant you could avoid going to university.
Well, I regret that now.
You regret not going to university?
I regret not going to university, as well as being in Roxy. But if I wouldn't be sitting here if I'd gone to university. I got turned down by the best universities. I mean, I did my
Cambridge
entrance and then, you know, walked into a cupboard on the way out, you know, and obviously I didn't get in. But what had happened, though, was when I was 16, I met 2 very important people who've turned out to be very, very important. And I said to my mother, yeah, I'll stay on at school and I'll do the exams and all that, but really I want to be a pop musician, rock musician. She was this lovely lady, obviously, from Cartagena. She said, I know cumbia, I know salsa, merengue. Rock music, what the hell's that? My brother, who's 8 years older than me, said, okay, I know this guy, he's just joined a band last week. I've known him from Cambridge. Let's go and talk to him and ask him what you have to do to become a professional musician. And that person was called David Gilmour. And he just joined Pink Floyd the week before. So age, you know, 16, almost 17, we go and have lunch with him. He can't remember what he said. He said, it must have been something great, because 5 years later, you managed to join Roxy Music. But we left the lunch, we went to his apartment, which from the window you could see Sid Barrett, where Sid Barrett lived. He had an apartment there as well. He got his guitar, I remember him putting it in his case, and he got in a taxi, he went to Abbey Road to start recording what was the first album that he played on, which was Source Full of Secrets.
Yeah. Right.
And and the other person I met was a British musician from a band called Soft Machine called Robert Wyatt when I was 16. So, you know, if you meet people when you're a teenager and they don't seem like from another world, you think, oh, maybe I could do that. So I always had that sort of desire to get into a band, or even though we had school bands, that... So I think about, 18 months after I left
school.
You auditioned for Roxy and they turned you down.
Yeah, they did. Fools. No, I answered an ad in a newspaper, in the Melody Maker newspaper. It said, the perfect guitarist wanted for avant rock group. So I rang and I went round to this little house in Battersea, working men's cottage, and there were two, what I consider to be grown-ups there. They were like 5 years older than me. They'd been to university. They had bank accounts. They had a car. They were teachers, Brian Ferry and Andy Mackay. They were sharing a house together. And Eno. And Brian Eno was there. So I thought, these guys are kind of special, kind of weird. I really want to be a part of this. And we had what they call a jam session, but they could hardly play the instruments, quite frankly. I mean, really, it was just like two chords. I thought, this is wonderful. Wonderfully refreshing. I'd just been playing progressive rock with all funny time signatures and everything, and I was like free at last. And anyway, I failed. I failed the audition. I could not believe it. I thought, these guys are going to be successful. I so much wanted to. But I kept bumping into them in London at concerts, avant-garde concerts with Eno and stuff like that. And they had got this guy called David List, who was in a band called The Nice. And he was quite famous. And he was a fantastic guitarist. And I thought, well, fair play. He's got the job. And but then he'd gone loopy. He'd been spiked in America with LSD. It can't be my phone, surely. I think it is. It's an Italian guy. So he was a bit wonky, and you know, it didn't work out. And then they asked me to come and mix the sound. And I said, mix the sound? I don't know the first thing about mixing the sound. They said, don't worry, Eno will teach you, because he's been banned from being on stage because he makes everybody too nervous. So he's out in the audience mixing the sound, and he knows what to do. And when I got to this rehearsal place, which was a derelict house just off Portobello Road, but it had electricity, they said, oh, there's a guitar there. Do you fancy having a go? Now, I thought that this might happen. So I secretly learnt all their numbers. And so I said to them, I can see it right now. I said, okay, you show me how it goes, and then I'll learn it. And they played it once. Okay, let's play it. I said, and they said, let's do another one. And I did this about 5 times. I said, would you join the band? And, you know, 2 days later, that was 2 days after my 21st birthday. The following week is the date of the first Roxy Music contract. 3 gigs later, I was in the studio recording the first Roxy Music album. 3 months later, the album, first Roxy Music album, came out on the same day as Ziggy Stardust, David Bowie. The following Saturday, we supported David Bowie at the Croydon, a pub in Croydon. And 2 months later, we support him at the Rainbow Theatre in London. And our album went to number 4 in the chart. So it all happened incredibly quickly. And
about a year after that,
We came here.
No, I was a year after that, I was 14 years old. Yeah. And my mother, for once, allowed me out of the house to go and see Alice Cooper at Wembley in 1972.
Chopping heads off
and that sort of thing.
Normal.
And what I wasn't expecting was the support band, which was Roxy Music, and you played Virginia Plain, your first sort of monster hit. And from the minute I heard that, I never forgot you and the band. That was the first time I met you, and you didn't know that I had...
I had no idea that you were there.
I had no idea, but there I was. Anyway.
You're a lot younger than
I know, I look very young. It's very true. Look, so what I wondered about is that 2 or 3 years before that, you were a slightly anxious teenager wanting to, you know, wanting to get into the business. And then 2 years later, you're playing at Wembley, for God's sake, or you're backing up David Bowie. I mean, what does that do to your head?
Well, you just do it. You know? I remember actually asking my mum, who was a widow by then, you know, did she have any temazepams, which are sort of like tranquilizers? But it's what I always wanted to do. I was so proud to be in a band, you know, and to be in a band with these guys who were like, it's like a bunch of freaks, really, let's face it. But unique sort of people. And it was like Christmas every day because more and more people said they liked the band. You know, influential people like the disc jockey John Peel and the journalists were saying they liked it. And there was something fantastic.
Well, we'll talk about those weird and wacky people after the break. But before we go into a break, you're going to play another. You're going to play a Latin America mix. So this is saying goodbye to Latin America in this half of the this half of the show. And but I'll let you get yourself again set up. I dare say it'll be fairly swift this time. And then we'll have a break, and Phil will sign the books for you.
Yes. When I started learning to play the guitar, it wasn't most rock musicians and guitarists in the UK in the 60s and 70s, they used to buy a book called Bert Weedon's Playing a Day. Well, there was none of that for me. It was sort of South American kind of music. And it was the kind of music that really, from Cuba, that ended up, if you've heard the Buena Vista Social Club, it's that kind of, it's almost like folk music with a groove behind it, but it's not salsa or anything like that. And it tends to be songs and music that comes from Santiago de Cuba. So I thought I would just play along with a little bit of the groove of one of their songs called Chan Chan. And if you wanted to dance, feel free. Thank you.
mind. Have a drink. We'll see you in 15 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats for the second half of tonight's evening. And we start this half with a special mix. And Phil, can you explain what this mix is and what the audience has to do?
Sing along.
Sing along, yes. Sing along a Phil.
So what I've done what I've called a mashup. I've made a mashup. I've joined together elements of Roxy music tracks and a few of my solo tracks and a track I did with Jay-Z and Kanye West. So it lasts. So let's see if you can spot where these riffs come from. Okay, it's not that easy. That's not the one. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bloody phones.
Phil, tell us what that last thing was.
Okay, that little last bit was the end of a track called Jealous Sky. And that was the very last time... The backing track was the very last time it was played at the O2 in London 2 years ago. And that's the last time Roxy will ever play live again. So I thought I'd just shove that in at the end. So you get a little taste of what it was like in the last time.
So, Phil, come on, the time has come. Reveal all. What's it like working with Brian Ferry and Brian Eno?
Well, it's fabulous, obviously. Now, you've got to remember, we're talking about 52 years of being friends and enemies and working business partners. And, you know, I'm sure all of you know, in your workplace, sometimes people drive you up around the bend, and sometimes you want to strangle them. Other times you're a lot more friendly, and when you have a creative partnership, it can be difficult. And sometimes it's good, because there is a tension, an artistic tension, when you're working, collaborating on things together. And you hope that it produces a better end result than if just one person did it. So all, you know, Brian Eno worked with us for 2 years.
And is that all?
Yeah, only 2 years. And then I worked with him for another 2 or 3 years, actually, and he's been on all my solo stuff over the years. And but he's a unique kind of person. They're two totally different kind of artists coming from different positions, if you like. You know, the person who taught art to Brian Eno was actually the same person who taught art to Pete Townsend. And it comes from a totally different kind of art school background to what Brian Ferry studied, fine arts, with the most famous British pop art artist, Richard Hamilton, up in Newcastle. So it's very different, you know, and to a certain extent, through writing this book, you know, and trying to make sense of what happened in the last 52 years and evaluate what was Roxy and you know, come to some idea of what happened. And in my own theory, it is mine, is that I thought I was joining a band in the sense of like the Beatles or the Stones, not in the sense of their grandeur, but in the sense of four musketeers or five musketeers all together, and they all, you know, we saw the Beatles films and we thought they all lived in the same house and they all had such fun running around and, and laughter and everything. That's what I thought, and that's what I sort of craved for, and I understand why I wanted that, because I was sort of almost brought up an only child, but then went to a boarding school and had lots of boys and around me and stuff like that, so camaraderie. Now I think that really this was some kind of weird art project of like Eno thinking it's one type of thing and Brian thinking it's another kind of art project, and it was like an art collective, really, made up of individuals who all contributed, had different ideas and different thoughts, but who worked together in music. Now, there's no precedent for that in art. Can you imagine in the 20s in Paris, you know, Picasso and Miro and whoever, they said, let's do a joint painting all together, you know, it would have been a disaster, and nobody did that, but Roxy was something special, you know, there was lots of different kinds of Roxy, so you get the two Brians working together in that first iteration of Roxy, but it was very much down to the process that we used to write the music and the songs was very different to what anyone else did, because none of us could write a decent song between us. Not like Paul McCartney or John Lennon, sit down at a piano and hum a melody and then a few words and then progress it, build up a song, and then go in and record it. 98% of all the Roxy music tracks, with Brian Eno and without Brian Eno, were done by doing the music first, creating a soundscape, if you like, into which, and a musical world into which this guy with a weird voice and very interesting lyrics could go into, and all these fantasies could come out. So it was a very dangerous way of working, because things could go wrong.
Yeah, presumably the guy with the weird voice who could create these worlds.
And a good-looking guy.
I mean, it's no secret that he was an oversized personality within Roxy.
You say that, but, you know, having given him a few drinks, and he's one of the lads, you know. But, no, I mean, I understand now that he is a real artist. You know, he likes to do beautiful things. He was taught about fine art and to create beautiful things. He wanted to create beautiful things. And if somebody got in his way, then obviously he would get annoyed. However, there's music involved in this as well. It's not all the visual aspect. And, you know, we had a fantastic producer, Chris Thomas, who worked with George Martin. He was George Martin's right hand, and worked with the Beatles and everything. And he taught us how to make records, and he taught us how to evaluate a good idea. So whoever came up with a good idea, it was manifestly the best idea, and that's the idea that went, regardless of who came up with it. And, you know, the working process of achieving what Roxy, you know, the musical side of Roxy, you know, the visual side of Roxy was very much part of Brian's fairy's dream and his imagination and his friends that worked with him. You know, there's Nick DeVille, who was at Study Fine Art with Richard Hampton and him, who became a professor at Goldsmith in London and taught all the young British, the YBAs and things. And Anthony Price, who was a fashion designer, very famous, young at the time, fashion designer, who was bringing new looks. And it was like the new kids on the block when we turned up.
Yeah, because you did set a trend in some ways. Yeah. I mean, you set a trend with glam rock, but also you almost anticipated the new romantics of the 1980s in terms of moving on from the hippie into the...
And let me say something about the word glam rock.
Yeah.
Because I had this discussion with David Bowie lots of times, because we came up at the same time. And he said, the thing is, Phil, trying to do a David Bowie accent, but I can't. There's high glam and low glam. We were high glam. And there was low glam.
Which was the Sweet and Gary Glitter.
You got
I
it.
I presume.
You got it.
Good. So, but look, I want to talk a little bit about the economics of music, because it was quite surprising to me in your book, you revealed that for a long time after you had hit the heights with Roxy Music, you were in debt. We sort of hear now about musicians complaining about Spotify and Apple Music, how they, you know, suck all the funds out of the industry and into the corporate world. But from the way you describe how things were run in the 1970s, it doesn't appear to have been much different. Or is it a fundamentally different model you're dealing with now?
The whole paradigm of the music industry has changed with technology, has changed everything. However, back in the 70s, you used to tour to sell records. Now there's no records to sell. So the touring is the main source of income. That's why so many bands play in concerts. And
And many bands are reforming because you get these huge audiences across generations now.
Yeah, there's that as well. But to be fair, we weren't very different from lots of bands. I mean, I read Roger Daltrey's memoir, and bizarrely, for me, reading it, finding out that they weren't making any money either, when I thought they were hugely famous and successful. And
the Who?
Yeah, The Who. And the reason was that you'd go on tour in America, and the expenses and everything was paid for by the band. So you'd go to America and tour and come back with a huge loss. So you may be, you know, breaking even or making some money in the UK or in Europe, but you were losing it all. But you were sort of investing in your long-term future. So there was a, you know, that was what every time, you know, my mother would say to me, but you've been on Top of the Pops, you've had number ones, where's the money? And I'd go in, and, you know, I was in my 20s, and I'd go in to the accountant, manager accountant, who, you know, have all managing accountants are that close to being in jail, and promoters, quite frankly. And I say, where's the money, Sam? He said, well, sorry, Phil, you know, no, it's because you did the American tour, you know, and it's like, damn. But, yeah, I mean, the first time I went into profit was when Roxy stopped touring after Avalon. So that's in 1982. So 10 years of borrowing money. I had huge bank loans and all sorts of things. And, you know.
So all this time you're living this, you know, incredibly glamorous rock lifestyle, but, you know, you're checking your bank accounts the whole time and saying, oh.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just the way. But when you're young, you don't really care to a certain extent.
Right.
You know, it's before I had family and stuff like that. So you're out there for the fun.
Yeah.
You know, join a band, see the world.
While we're on this economic subject, tell us about the most lucrative thing you've ever written. Because I think you played it earlier on.
I did. And this is one of the anomalies of the music business, is the randomness of things that can happen. So in 2015, I was in my car near Portobello Road in London, and I was driving with my son, and the phone went, a mobile phone went, and obviously it's illegal to speak on the phone, so obviously I handed it to my son, and honest governor. And it was a voice from a record company in America, New York, Rockefeller Records. He said, hi, my name's a blah, blah, blah from Rockefeller Records. Just to tell you that Jay-Z and Kanye West have sampled your guitar, and they've written a whole song around it, and it's coming out next week on their album. It's the first track, and it's the single on their album. And I said, whoa, 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 hang on. People always get my name mixed up with the keyboard player in The Doors, Ray Manzarek. So it's not me. They said, oh. They said, no, no, it is you. We'll play it to you down the phone because we can't send it to you because it's too top secret. So I put on speakerphone and I said to my son, record it. And so we're going to get one back on these guys. So anyway, and it went bing, bang, 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 bang.
Can you play that that one riff?
And it took me years to learn how to play it again. Because I did it, I wrote it like watching the television one night when I needed to do an instrumental the next day in the studio. And I went, I said, that'll do. Let's go in, we'll record it. 40 years later, they sampled it. And anyway, they... I said, hang on, are you allowed to do that? They said, well, yes. This is Virgin Records. I said, but what about if they had, like, some obscene lyrics on it? Or sort of, whatever. I'm not going to say any obscene lyrics. But they said, no, look, don't worry. You're going to be happy. I said, why am I going to be happy? Because we've negotiated a deal where you get more than they do. I said, are you sure? said, okay, right. So I put the phone down. Well, I didn't have the phone, obviously. but I said, well, hang on, I wrote it as well, so there's a publishing. I rang up the publisher, Universal Publishing. Do you know anything about this? Oh, yeah, I've been negotiating this for months. I said, well, shouldn't you have told me anything? Don't worry, you'll be very happy. So why? Because you're going to get more than they... Well, it came out, it was number one, it won a Grammy, it was in the Great Gatsby film, it was in Safe House with Denzel Washington, it was in all these car ads, and I discovered that that's where the money is. And if you can imagine a one-armed bandit, sort of machine, slot machine, and the thing's going round, and it was like the apples are all coming out.
Seven, seven, seven.
And yeah, I thought, oh my goodness, how did that happen? Thank you, God. Seven figures, that's all I can say. And more than I'd earned with Roxy. But since writing the book, shall I tell you what's happened? 10 years later, it happened again.
What with?
Well, you don't know this.
No, I don't.
No church in the wild.
Yeah.
That in the trailer for the new Gladiator 2 film, yeah, which comes out on the 1st of November, my son rang and said, go to 1 minute 54 and tell me what you hear. What?
And it's the same riff.
It's no church in the world. And
this was something you wrote and put on your first solo album, which
not first solo, but 1975, 6 or something, 7 right, or something, I did it. But it's come back again. So it's like karma. And so, you know, I think, okay, just stay in your lane, do good music, don't worry about anything else, things will happen. And that's in the memoir, that's what I've ended up thinking, my God, all these things happened. How did they happen? And I can, you know, it's as if I'm making it up. But these things, like, happen. So I do believe in this sort of karma thing.
Well,
Oh, God.
You've had a couple of occasions, though, when karma almost went the other way. To wind up, a couple of stories. One was when you were curating this extraordinary event in Seville of the guitar, what was it called? The guitar...
Guitar Legends.
When Tony Hollingsworth, this guy, rang you up and said, will you come and create the Guitar Legends? Curate it in Seville. And tell us about dealing with Bob Dylan.
Okay, so Guitar Legends was what they call a pre-event for Expo. Expo 90, or was it 91? 91. Sorry, that's my prompt. Off. And so this guy rang me and said, we're going to put on 5 nights live on television on BBC Two and in America. I don't know if they showed it in Europe, live from Seville, from this outdoor auditorium. There's a budget of $7 million. You can choose, it's called Guitar Legends. It's about supposedly the home of the guitar in Seville. You can choose concepts for each night. You can ring up the best guitarists in the world, the best bass players, the best drummers, the best everything. The stage set is going to be done by the people who do Pink Floyd. It's going to be an amazing event. Do you want to do it?
So, and you managed to get...
I said, hang on, I think I'm busy on that. No. So I then create, you know, I had one blues night, one folk night, one rock night, one whatever night, and then I ran out of concepts. So I'm going to do a night with all the leftovers. So my leftovers were Jack Bruce, Bob Dylan, Joe Cocker, Keith Richards, Steve Cropper, you know, the most incredible bunch of people. And so they said, okay, well, yeah, we've got Bob Dylan, but you're going to have to rehearse him. And he's coming over, and there's a rehearsal space underneath the stage. So we're talking about Seville in September, beginning of September, it's like 90 degrees or 100 degrees. It's sort of air conditioned. below. So the door opens and in comes Bob Dylan, and he's wearing a parka because obviously it's air conditioned and he doesn't want to ruin his voice. So this green thing comes towards me, and his manager introduces, said, "Phil, this is Barb," as if I didn't know who it was. "Barb, this is Phil." Obviously, he didn't know who I was. So who's this guy? I think he thought I was Mexican. Obviously, a name like Manzanera, but you don't get many six-foot-tall Mexicans, let's face it. I have a son-in-law who's Mexican, so I can talk about Mexicans. He's relatively tall. And the reason I say that is that the organizer of the festival had said to me, "Whatever you do, make sure he plays All Along the Watchtower," which is one of his songs. I thought, that's great. But not his version, the Jimi Hendrix version. So there he was, and he was sitting there like here, and a bubble comes out of my head, and it's saying, how am I going to tell Bob Dylan that we're not playing his version? The words just weren't coming out. I said, look, we've got the most fantastic band here, the best drummers in the world, best everything, Jack Bruce and all sorts of people. I've got all your records. We can play anything you like, but we do have to play All Along Watchtower, but not your version. And so I could see his face. He said, you know what? Do you know a Tex-Mex song from 1947? I said, no. He said, anybody else know it? He said, no. I said, oh, you play it and we'll learn it. And then, because, you know, obviously you can play whatever you want. So he said, well, so he started playing it. He played it differently every time. And everybody was like looking at each other. And people started making excuses to leave the room. So I've got to make a phone call to my mother in back. So gradually, everybody left. It was just me and him. And he said, Phil, why don't we just play two acoustic guitars? I said, oh, no, they're going to kill me. This is going live. And then the manager came up and said, Bob might come on. He might not come on. So who's going to sing his songs if he's, you know, and I had Jack Bruce there, who's a Glaswegian, who then went into several Glaswegian expressions for no way am I doing it, but, you know. So I was like, how's this going to, I just speechless, you know. It's great having Bob Dylan there, but he set this trap. And this is his sort of MO.
His modus
operandi. Subsequently, you know, and there was the guy who's the producer of the show, the sound producer, was a guy called Phil Ramone, very famous American producer, who had produced a few Bob Dylan albums. And I had lunch with him and said, how do you record an album with him? He said, Phil, you just let him come in, he does whatever he wants, and then he goes, and then you just try and sort it out later. And then he did the same thing, the band, did a doco called The Last Waltz.
Yeah, The Last Waltz. Yeah.
And apparently he did the same thing on that. They didn't know whether it was going to come out or not. And same for George Harrison at the concert
for Bangladesh
in Madison Square Garden. I didn't really know this. I thought it was me. But then thinking about it, you know, I thought, well, he's Bob Dylan, do whatever he likes. But what happens if he doesn't come on? And the manager said, but if he does come on, make sure you introduce him. And I thought, anyway, we got to the night and it was live on television all over the world. And I thought, what happened was I knew there was this British folk guitarist called Richard Thompson from a band called Fairport Convention, but he's famous in his own right. And I knew that Bob Dylan liked him. So he was playing a gig in Amsterdam. I rang him and I said, would you like to play with Bob Dylan? You know. Anybody was, yeah, sure, great. I said, okay, I'll send you your flight, get here tomorrow. He came, I said, go into the dressing room, this is before we went out to play live, find out what we're gonna play, because nobody had any idea what we were gonna play. So, and years later, I was doing a record with Richard, and I said, what happened when you went in the dressing room? And he said, Bob said to me, do you know this Tex-Mex song from 1947? I said, you've got to be joking. He said, no. And then he proceeded to play it differently every time. So it's on YouTube. If you can watch it, you can see us all, like, with fear in our eyes. I see him coming out, so I introduce him in Spanish. Señor y señora, señor Bob Dylan. They all go, ksh, and we're all going. And then you can see us making sign languages, like C for the C chord, and like G. And I've got no idea what the song is that he sang. You can listen to it. I've still got no idea.
Somebody I know described it as the Muppets singing all along the Watchtower.
Hey, look, can I just put a disclaimer in? I do adore Bob Dylan. Everything, his music and everything. Obviously, I don't want to work with him again, ever. But I love his songs, and I can listen to his music till I go to the grave, you know.
Okay, so we're going to have one more story before you finally play. But you've got to quickly tell us about your other unexpected phone call when you were invited to go and play during the 1990s, during a very, very turbulent time. You were invited to go and play in Cali, Colombia, I believe, with Roger Daltrey, who you mentioned earlier.
And David Gilmour. It was going to be... Well,
a charity gig.
No, it was for the World Environmental Conference. And this Colombian bass player that we knew said, would you like to come and play? You're not going to get paid, but there's first class airfares. You get to go to Cali, Colombia, and have a good time, blah, blah, blah. And so David Gilmour, it would be the first time that any Pink Floyd songs would have been played in South America, the first time any Who songs would have been played. So we rehearsed in England, and we had the manager of Pink Floyd. We all got on the plane, and I don't know what we were thinking, because it was a bunch of complete numpty musicians who had obviously hadn't read that the cartel in Medellin in Colombia were in the middle of a huge sort of killing spree amongst each other. So we set off. One of my cousins flies the plane from Bogota to Cali.
This is one of the 50 cousins who's now a Portuguese citizen.
Yes. And we arrive in Cali, and we go to sleep. And then the next morning, on the front of the newspaper, it says, do not go to the football stadium to the concert, because it's a money laundering exercise for the cartel. So the manager, who's the manager of Pink Floyd, knocks on the door of the bass player, puts him up. I'm following the manager, and he puts him up against, well, what the, you know, are you doing? Don't ever organize a concert. That's what we're going to do. In the end, we did play, again, it's on YouTube, to like an empty stadium full of machine guns and when I went back to Colombia at the Hay Festival in January, and I was interviewed by the editor of El Tiempo, which is like the top newspaper there, and he said, you know, this is like a legendary event that occurred, and people have written short stories about it. But the real story is that the cartel owned a football team, and when they heard that there was going to be this concert there, they thought, well, they're going to ruin the pitch. So we've got to try and stop this happening. And that was the way they put out the story, that it was for the cartel.
It was money laundering.
Money laundering. But it was really about, they were mad on football, the cartel. Well, so, you know, both cartels, they had football teams, didn't they? Well,
Phil,
not that you know.
Great story to end on, but we're not quite there, because you're going to finish off with Diamond Head, which is, of course, well, not of course, but it was inspired by your time as a boy in Hawaii.
Yes. So, well, again, as I said before, you know, you can call instrumentals whatever you like, quite frankly. But I've tended to call all the tracks that aren't songs or have lyrics after little bits of things that occurred in my lifetime. And after Cuba, we went to Honolulu, and I went to school there. And every day after school, I'd get on the American school bus and go to Waikiki Beach and meet my mum there, and as all children of that age do, go surfing. But at the end of the beach, there is a volcano, a mountain, and it's called Diamond Head. And so that's why I call this track Diamond Head. And also, funny enough, the B-side of the second Roxy Music single
is called
Hula Kula. And it is me, Brian, Andy, and Eno mucking about with me playing Hawaiian guitar. And the reason for that is because of being in. So there's always a little story behind everything.
I just want to point out before you start this one photograph, which was the last concert that David Bowie ever played. And Phil was there playing with him. And you might recognize there's David Gilmour, Robert Wyatt, and legendarily David Crosby there.
Yeah.
As well. And that was the last time David Bowie played and the first time you played with David Bowie.
At the Albert Hall in London, yeah. It was quite a moment for me.
Take it away, maestro.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was the end of the opening event of the Vienna Humanities Festival. Tomorrow evening, we have a slight change of tone when Baroness Catherine Ashton, former High Representative of the European Union, will be talking in the Festsaal of the Rathaus here. Be there or be square, as they used to say. And we've got lots of other events this week. But in the meanwhile, please, a rousing round of applause for Mr. Phil Manzanera, El Magnifico.